Hey everyone, today we're doing something a little different. We're doing an Ask Me Anything. Thank you all so much for your questions, of which there were a lot, so I suggest we get right to it. Let's start with our first question from Chris Murphy. How do you get comic work? For instance, how did you get to draw a story for Batman Black and White? Did they reach out to you? Do you have to audition for the job by sending samples? Or are you established enough that they trust you? So, 99% of the time, the editor comes directly to you with a project. They usually have a writer, a scheduled release, sometimes even scripts, and that's when they reach out to artists whose work they might have seen in another book or online. You might be the second or even the third artist they turn to because others have turned it down, but I've rarely heard of artists having to audition. I personally never had to, even when I was starting out, and I really think that goes a long way in boosting your confidence rather than enforcing practices that pit you against members of your own community. Next up, we have a question by Sinu. Hey Elsa, I wanted to ask how to send pitches for comics to publishers in these times of pandemic, especially if you are in a foreign country. If you've never worked professionally before, the best way to put your work in front of an editor is to create a comic. That's true for writers and that's true for artists. You need to know that editors are buried under email submissions. They don't often have the time to look at portfolios and, you know, reading a pitch is a whole other matter. So produce a short comic, put it on the internet, on Instagram or Twitter, wherever, and hope that enough people share it so it catches the eye of an editor. I would refrain against identifying them in post, though I'm pretty sure they hate that. And then if you can, have it printed and travel to a convention to the States, show it around, that's even better. Next up, we have a question from Mario Augusto. Could you share portfolio tips? What subjects to draw, characters, perspective, etc.? So in a comic book portfolio, ideally you have 12 pages. If you want to submit to the big two, have 6 pages with a Marvel character and 6 pages with a DC character. For each, you need a 4-page action sequence and a 2-page talking head sequence, and a couple of covers if you're interested in doing that. Tiago Palma, could you talk about page rates, industry standards, how you established yours and working for publishers opposed to creator-owned in financial terms? Page rates are, for very understandable reasons, an important subject, and it keeps coming up because it's hard to find data that actually represents the reality. That may be because not everyone is ready to share what they make, which I completely understand, so there aren't real industry standards. But $250 for an inked page seems to be a good place to start, and you should have 50% for colors. Thankfully, I didn't have to figure that out myself because my first pay gig was at Random House for George R.R. Martin's graphic novel, and of course they had a very generous budget. That set my first rate at $350 for inks, and that is a lot for a complete beginner. So that's what I asked for my next projects for a few years, and I often got it, and when I didn't, I would just turn the book down. And these days my rate is higher, but I also don't work for hire anymore, so it doesn't matter, because when you start working with publishers that offer creator-owned contracts, like Image Comics, everything you make is off sales. And for that, you need savings because there is a 6-month gap minimum between creating the book and actually getting residuals. If your book is successful, you could make a lot more than you would have a DC or Marvel, but I also think it's important to be realistic, and most of the time, it's less. Sarah Ferris is wondering, are you an architect or are you a gardener? So, for those of you who haven't seen my interview with Ed Brubaker, Sarah is referring to the difference between creators who will precisely structure their work in advance, architect, and gardeners who tend to rely more on gut feeling. Ed, for example, is more of a gardener. So I am a gardener in the sense that I don't need an overarching structure before I start. I don't map out my approach to storytelling ahead of time. I usually let the story carry me as I go, but in order for a page or a sequence to work, I also need a minimum amount of structure and logic to it. So in a much lesser degree, I am a bit of an architect, and when I write, I am definitely more of an architect. EJ White is wondering, as a writer, what can I do to make collaborations with artists as smooth and effective as possible? So my main suggestion would be to let your artists do their job and allow them to be their own creative half of the book. I'm happy to get a specific direction if the writer has a specific storytelling idea for one scene, but for the rest of the book, I want to be able to do my job freely, which doesn't mean drawing stuff that's not written, but being allowed to bring in my own interpretation of it. Also, always keep in mind, as you're writing for an artist, one action per panel. You can't have a character picking up a glass and going out the door in a single panel. Gunner 44. How can writer best visualize page layouts when writing stories? I learned to mostly write prose, so I struggle to know how to write for a comic effectively. First of all, it's completely normal to struggle. So one exercise that can be very helpful to you is to take any comic that you like and to write the script for it, to kind of reverse engineer it. It'll teach you everything you need to know about comics, how many beats can you put on a page, where to write in a page turn, how many words or balloon you can get away with, what an artist is able to put in the panel, what they can't, all of that. Okay, we have Moomin Writer. Any tips for picking the right perspective for establishing settings? Perspective is one of the hardest things to grasp in comics, I found, and the subject is way too vast to answer in a single question, but I will leave you with two tips. When it's not necessary to the story or to fit in balloons, keep the amount of ceiling and floors to a minimum because that's dead space, and for that you need to play with your horizon level. Perspective is like colors in the sense that you need to understand the theory behind it. There is no way around that. And there are great books that can help you figure it out. David Chelsea's Perspective for Comic Book Artists is a fantastic one, and it's the one that I used. And only once you understand the theory, you'll know what to put in your panels. This one is a bit of a follow-up. How do you think about the perspective? When it should be straight ahead versus overhead? Is there always logic to it, or is it down to make each panel a little different from the others on the page? There are a lot of considerations when it comes to placing characters. First, what does this panel say? How does it further the story? Do we need to share the characters' emotions, or on the contrary, have them more anchored in their environment? That will dictate how close you need to get to your characters. Then you have the power dynamic. Is there power central to the scene? In that case, you can angle your camera up for some key panels. Or are they being dominated? In that case, you angle it down. Then try as much as possible to picture it in your head first. That will help you naturally figure out perspective, but that can take a little bit of practice. So if you're not quite there yet, then I would suggest to sketch as many different versions until you land on one that's as close as possible to what you had in your mind. And to answer your question, the rule is every panel angle should be motivated by the story, by the characters. You shouldn't draw fancy effects just for the sake of it. Alex Soares, how can you manage with the big chunks of shadows in your art? It always seems difficult, even after studying other artists. I struggled for a long time with that. So I started out by reading a lot of Tim Sale, and I wanted to be able to reproduce what he was doing with his inks, but I did not understand it. So I took out shadows from my work entirely for a few years because I wasn't ready to do them right. And then, little by little, I began incorporating them back, very timidly first, then more and more, as I kept studying other artists' work. And to me, studying doesn't mean just looking at art, but actually copying it. I feel as an artist, that's the best way to learn. And when you feel like a shadow you put in is not working, try to understand why it sticks out and compare it to another that works. So I'm sorry, I don't have any shortcuts. Studying others is probably the only way to learn this, as well as trial and error. But keep in mind that learning how to draw takes very, very long time, and only then you'll be more comfortable with your mistakes. Next up, we have Luis Zuko. I would really like to know more about your process, the steps you take, and the materials you use, brand, brush sizes, all of that. P.S. Love the channel. Thank you so much. I mentioned before, I think that Chris Samney is the one who recommended I use Kuretake pens, and it completely changed my inking. I used to ink with microns, but I don't know, I just could never make them work for me. So now I do my inking with a medium model of Kuretake, which has a very flexible and soft tip, and it's absolutely brilliant to produce smooth and bouncy lines. Now the extra fine one tip is very stiff, so it doesn't offer a variety of line width, but that's actually great because I use it to contrast the softer lines. I'll typically use it for patterns on clothes and for backgrounds. But what I like about any inking tool is that you can completely adapt them to your work. What I do with my Kuretake doesn't look like what Samney does at all, because we don't have the same technique, because our end pressure is different, and many other reasons. I like pens because you don't have to dip them in an ink bottle every 30 seconds, and also the technique is pretty easy to grasp, and I basically only use a brush to fill in my blacks. My advice on tools is that you should never spend too much, at least at the beginning. It's a little different for brushes because a high quality brush can make a world of difference, but keep in mind that you'll want to explore at first, so try many different inexpensive options and see what you like best. A question from John. If you had to take time off from work, let's say you're in a bunker for 6 months, avoiding a plague of stink bugs or something, and could only do one exercise to keep your drawing skills from getting rusty, what would it be? I would be more concerned about retaining my storytelling skills than my drawing skills, because you can get away with an imperfect drawing if your storytelling is impeccable, but the reverse isn't true. I'm assuming during this plague of stink bugs that I have access to books, I hope, because otherwise it is not a world I want to live in. So one exercise that helped me a lot when I started out was studying other artists' storytelling, like doing small thumbnails of their pages, roughly sketching the art to understand eye flow, angles, and framing. And sometimes I will only look at grids. For example, this past weekend, I took out my black and white oversized edition of Hellboy in Hell, and I sketched out dozens of tiny grids. Nunchak, how do you manage work-life balance? Well, you'll have to ask someone else and then you tell me how they do it. B-things, how do you keep focused and get pages drawn in a timely manner without burning out? I pick projects I really believe in. It's been years since I've been paired with a writer by an editor, and nowadays, since I only do creator-owned books, I reach out to writers I want to work with, who I know can produce scripts that will keep me engaged and technically challenged. That's what motivates me to get to the drawing table every morning and not wander around the internet. I'm excited to draw, and when I'm engaged in the narrative, I don't see the hours go by. But I can start to feel burnout when I haven't had a chance to recharge in a long time, like typically only having one day off a week or working until 10 at night. That will bum me out after a while, so I would say a good script and sufficient time off. Devin, your work in November reminded me a lot of Darwin Cook's.
Thank you.
If given the opportunity, would picking up where he left off with the Parker novels be something that would interest you? Why or why not? Parker is a bit of a dream project for me, as you guessed, but I'm not sure I'll ever feel up to the task, because it might be my favorite series of all time, and there's a part of me that would prefer it to remain as an inspiration to maybe reach that level of mastery someday, so I probably wouldn't want to taint that feeling. Brian is asking, do you prefer more or less direction when being commissioned? Honestly, I would rather have no direction than too much, but I don't mind a commissioner asking about a certain facet of the character that like me to focus on. On your Harley Quinn Dr. Quinzel piece, you asked about Harleen becoming Holly, and that's the sort of direction that doesn't stifle my creativity, because I can come up with all sorts of interpretation of that idea. On the other hand, I've had in the past commissioners asking for a character in a specific position, with a specific background and framed in a very specific angle, and that I usually won't want to do because it feels like I'm just here to put down what they have in mind rather than surprise them with my interpretation. And Jeff is asking, is your commission process the same as your narrative pages? It is exactly the same as for a page. I will usually do thumbnails on paper, pencil digitally, and ink on paper. Thank you all so much for your great questions. I couldn't film all of them, sadly, but I will be answering others directly in the comments of this video. Make sure that you subscribe to my channel, and I will see you next time.